Okay, so you're talking about phasors. So what we said is, if we have a source, AC source, AC source, by the way, sometimes we would represent also as this, right? So if you have an AC source, V of T, and this source is connected to a network G, which is a linear circuit network. In that case, this response of the circuit, or the currents and the voltages that would appear, would also be real. And if we represent, and it would be real and would be of the same frequency, omega naught, right? So this would have I and V real and of frequency omega naught, right? And this gave us step one, where what we said was that if I replace this source with another source, which is, now this V of T is, let's say, Vm cos of omega t plus theta, I can replace this source with Vm e raised power j omega t plus theta, which essentially has the same real component, but also has a imaginary component, right? And if I still supply to this network G, then now my currents and voltages would have both real and complex, right? But then if I only pick the real one, I would get the answer corresponding to the real voltage that I applied, right? So whether I solve the first circuit or I solve the second circuit and then find the real part of the answer, or real part of, let's say, some current I want to find, IA. Huh? So if I find real part of IA, I would get the same answer as above. Is this part clear? So I can always, instead of using a real source, I can always use a complex source, as long as I'm talking about linear circuit network, right? This was one thing. Now, next thing is, in this expression, which is Vm e raised power j omega naught t plus theta, there are essentially two terms. One is Vm e raised power j omega naught and e raised power j theta, right? So now this part would be same for all the currents and voltages in a circuit, right? Why? Because everything is rotating at omega naught, right? So therefore, if we fix a frequency omega for a circuit, we need not write this term again and again for each current and voltage, right? So therefore, we represent phasor usually by this kind of symbol as Vm by 2 angle theta, where this is nothing but the RMS value of that quantity, and this is the angle, right? So this can be also written as Vm by root 2, which is the RMS value, and theta, which is the angle. So it can be written as Vm by root 2 e raised power j theta, right? So this is what represents phasor. Now, as we saw in the last class, if you have two voltages, V1 of t, which is capital V1 cos of omega naught t plus theta 1, and V2 of t, which is capital V2 cos of omega naught t plus theta 2, right? You see that both the sources are of same frequency. So if you have two sources of same frequency, and if you want to add them, we can write V1 of t plus V2 of t is V1 cos of omega naught t plus theta 1 plus V2, okay, cos of omega naught t plus theta 2, right? So you can always write, let's say this is my total V of 3t. I can always write this, and I can add some imaginary part plus j V1 sine of omega naught t plus theta 1 plus jv2 sine of omega naught t plus theta 2, and I can take real of this, right? So if I'm taking real of this, that means irrespective of the imaginary part that I add, my final answer would not change. This I can rewrite as real of v1 e raised power j omega naught t plus theta 1 plus v2 e raised power j omega naught t plus theta 2, which I can rewrite as real part of, I can take e raised power j omega naught t common, and it will essentially be into root 2 phasor corresponding to v1 plus phasor corresponding to v2. Right? So if I want to add two sources, I can just add their correspond. I can convert those two sources into phasors, then add the two phasors, then convert them back to time domain. Right? So I would still get the same answer. This inherently gives us a confidence that basic Kirchhoff's current law and Kirchhoff's voltage law is applicable also to phasors. Right? Why? Because KVL says that summation of voltage in a loop is zero, sigma VI is zero. You can always convert those time domain into phasor. That would show you that sum summation of the phasors also is zero in a loop. And similarly, summation of all the currents, phasors at a node is also zero. That means phasors follow KCL and KVL. Is that okay? Right. By the way, what is this phasor? If I see, what is this phasor V1? Phasor V1 is nothing but like a vector on imaginary and real axis whose magnitude is capital V1 by root 2, which is the RMS value, and angle is theta 1. Right? And it's a stationary vector phasor. So phasor we would sometime write either in polar form or in rectangular form, and sometimes we would represent in the real imaginary plane. So now, for example, if you have to add two phasors, right, you can just draw them on this real imaginary plane and then you can add. Okay, any doubt till now? Right. Say again, yes. If we have 2 pi, no, nothing will change because you will again come back to the same point, right? Yeah, so adding 2 pi would not change. Cos 2 pi plus theta is cos theta, sin 2 pi plus theta. And it is a stationary, it is not rotating, right? So phasors are stationary, they are not rotating. But we all understand that when I am drawing this phasor which is stationary, I have assumed that this is operating at, circuit is operating at frequency omega naught, right? Now what happens to the resistance? Let's say I have a resistance R, and so if you have a resistance R, right, and let's say there is a current which is flowing through this resistance R, which I have written as some capital Im cos of omega naught t plus theta 1. Right? What will be the voltage across this resistance that would get developed? It will be the current multiplied by the resistance, right? Which is Im into R into cos of omega naught t plus theta 1. Is that okay? Right? Now in time domain, this is 5. Now in phasor domain also, would the voltage across the resistance and current through the resistance follow the same law? Yes, we all know it would, right? We can quickly show. So let's say if I convert this current into the phasor, so I write capital I is Im by root 2 angle theta 1. And I convert this voltage into phasor, I say capital V is Im into R by root 2 angle theta 1. And then I can write R is nothing but given by capital V phasor by I phasor, right? Where R is a real value, right? So that means for resistance, phasor also obeys the same law as that of normal time domain signal, right? That is V is equal to IR, where V is a phasor V, I is a phasor I. Both are complex, right? But R is a real value. Is that okay? Up till now, everything is fine. So if, let's say, if you have an R, that R would behave as the same R even in phasor equivalent circuit. Huh? Now, what happens to L? If you have an inductor whose value is L, how would this L behave in terms of phasor equivalent? So, inductor would follow this law, right? V is equal to L di by dt, right? Let me assume that my current is given by capital Im cos of omega naught t, right? Then how would my voltage look like? V of t is nothing but L times derivative of this. It would be Im into omega naught derivative of cos is minus sine of omega naught t. I can rewrite it as L Im omega naught cos of sine minus omega naught t plus pi by 2. Is that okay? So I just want to bring again in terms of cos, right? Which was the way I represented current. So I also wanted to represent voltage in terms of some magnitude cos omega naught t plus some angle. Is that okay till now? Okay, now if I write I phasor, how would I phasor look like? I phasor would be Im by root 2 angle 0, and V phasor would look like Im L omega naught by root 2 angle pi by 2. Right? So here I define something called as impedance, which is defined as the ratio of V phasor by I phasor, which is I would represent usually for inductor Z subscript L, and this is given by L omega naught angle pi by 2, right, which can also be written as L omega naught cos theta plus J sine theta, which is J omega naught L. So that means if I have an inductor and I take the voltage phasor across it and the current phasor flowing through it, the ratio of the voltage phasor by current phasor would be given by this expression. That means in the phasor equivalent, inductor is behaving in a way as a resistance whose resistance value is given by this particular complex value J omega naught into L, right? So if I convert a time domain circuit into a phasor domain circuit, right, I can just replace an inductor with a fictitious resistance whose value would be given by J omega naught L, right? Also, as we discussed before, that we can always draw these phasors also, right? So let's say this is imaginary axis, this is real axis. So how would I phasor look like? I phasor would actually be If this is your I phasor, your V phasor is 90 degrees plus, right? So that means this is your V phasor, right? For an inductor, where this is your inductor and this is your I phasor and this is your V phasor, right? So you can also draw I phasor and V phasor in the same plane. If you see this, since this angle is positive, we call it that the voltage phasor is leading current phasor by 90 degrees. Or in other words, we can say that the current phasor is lagging voltage phasor by 90 degrees. For asking, yeah. So this is, if you see phasor, we are representing at steady state, and if the frequency is omega naught, right? Then only we convert a time domain circuit into a phasor circuit. So once you have converted into phasor circuit, then ZL is nothing but a constant. Why? Because we are at steady state. So nothing is changing. L is L. We are not changing L, right? Omega naught is also constant. So ZL is nothing but a constant, but it is a complex value. Is that something answers your question?
We have represent ZL also there. So if we just represent I bar into the original function, we see that we have represented I am cos. So why we are not doing that?
For Z. No, so Z is nothing but a ratio of two phasors, right? So what was voltage phasor if you convert time domain voltage into voltage? What was current phasor is when you convert time domain current into current. How do we define Z phasor, or how do we define Z? I'm not calling it Z phasor, right? I'm just calling it Z. How do I define Z? Ratio of voltage phasor by current phasor. Why I'm doing that? So that I can get an parallel or similarity between this and resistance, right? Which would help us solve the AC circuits in steady state. For Z? Yeah, Z is a complex value, right? So it may have some real part, it may have some complex part. Resistance was real, impedance can be complex, right? Here we see that impedance of an inductor is J omega naught L. Impedance of some other element may be something else, right? Any other doubt? Okay, then can you guys quickly find what is going to be ZL or ZC, right? So for a capacitor. And I also want you to draw the voltage and current. So if you have a capacitor, right, you represent, this is your reference direction, right? So this is your current through the capacitor. This is voltage across capacitor, right? Now you can here, you can, for simplicity, you can start with voltage as Vm cos of omega naught t, right? And then you can find I of t, I C dv by dt. Then you can find ZC by dividing V phasor with I phasor. And you get, okay, so what is ZC? ZC is given by 1 upon J omega C, right, or omega naught C. Is that okay? Right, if you are not able to find out, you let me know. After class, I can also help you find out ZC. By then, if you follow the same process, then you would be able to find ZC also. So what does this actually mean? This means that if you have an AC circuit, okay, by how about the phasor, how would it look like? If your V is like this, then your current would be down, right? That means here, in capacitor, your voltage is leading current. In inductor, current was leading voltage, right? So current was lagging. Current was lagging. In the inductor, current is lagging voltage. In capacitor, no. Okay, sorry. Yeah, so if we draw phasor and if we take voltage as the reference here, then my current would be somewhere here. So here current is leading, in inductor current was lagging, right? Okay, now in AC circuit, therefore, what all things do we have in AC circuit? If you see, we have resistance, we have inductors, we have capacitors. In steady state, in DC, inductor would behave as a short circuit. Why? Because frequency is, I mean, it's debatable whether you call frequency zero or infinite, but then the inductor would become short circuit. Why? Because V is L di by dt, I is constant, di by dt is zero, so V is zero. But here, L does not become short circuit. In fact, we convert it to, when we convert these things to phasors, phasor equivalent circuit, then we would represent them by R, ZL, ZC, and KCL and KVL would also satisfy as it is. And therefore, all the things that we have studied in the basic DC circuit analysis, right? So if you see, if this was the, if you're talking about AC circuit, if this was the time domain thing, and this is the phasor, then in time domain, you can also use other basic laws, such as, so there are two basic laws, KCL, KVL. Then in the beginning of this course, we saw few more laws, right? Those were, or few more techniques or methods of solving circuit, like mesh analysis, nodal analysis, Thevenin, Norton, superposition. What else? Am I missing something? So all of these are also applicable for phasors. Why? Because all of them were based on some basic principles. Principles was that circuit has to be linear. Some of them are based on that, right? And your circuit should satisfy KCL, KVL. Now, because this phasor circuit also satisfy KCL, KVL, and the circuit still remains linear, right? Because V vector is nothing but Z vector into I vector, right? So still circuit is linear. So all those techniques are also applicable to solve phasor equivalent circuit. Anyone has any doubt in this part? Okay, then let's start with some problems, right? Because when we solve something, maybe we'll be able to clarify if at all there is some doubt. So let's say I give you this network. There is a resistance of 100 ohm. There is an inductor of 10 millihenry. There is a capacitor of 10 microfarad. And there is a resistance of 50 ohm. And let's say I tell you that I am connecting an AC voltage source across it, and I give you the RMS value of this source. Let's say it is 230 volts, and I give you the frequency, which is, let's say I give you the omega naught here instead of giving frequency in F, which is 104 radians per second, right? So I tell you the RMS value of the voltage, I tell you the frequency, right? And I ask you what is going to be the RMS current that would flow in this circuit. Do you understand the question? So there is a network of R, L, and C, and I apply an AC voltage of 230 volt, whose frequency is 104 radians per second, and I'm asking for the RMS current. So now if you see in any circuit, one basic thing is, how do we solve the AC steady state circuits? We would try to convert this thing into phasor, right? And then we solve the circuit, and then we would again come back into time domain and represent the answer in time domain. At this stage, you know the magnitude, you know the angle. To write this V1 of t, we would actually need one more thing, right? Which is plus theta naught, right? Do you know theta naught in this particular question? No, but? Yeah, you can take some reference zero, right? Why? Because there is no other current and voltage defined in time domain. Then you can assume it to be zero. If, let's say, hypothetically, there would have been one source somewhere inside this circuit where I would have written this source in terms of time domain is some 10 cos omega naught t plus 15. Then you cannot define this as zero, right? In this question, there was no angle defined anywhere, or neither of any voltage nor of any current. And therefore, I could define one of them as angle zero. Can take one of voltage or current at angle zero if no other voltage or current in the circuit no other voltage or current in the circuit is defined. Is that okay? You can take one of the angle of either one of the current or one of the voltage to be zero as a reference if none of the other voltage or current phase is defined. Right? So you be a little bit careful. Huh? Sometimes I see people making this mistake that circuit may have some values given in RMS. Some values given in exact time domain, so cos of omega naught t plus theta. And sometimes you still take that RMS value and you write the expression as angle theta equal to 0, right? You cannot do that. Is that okay? Okay. So now our first thing is, okay, we should know these time domain voltage. Now if we know this time domain voltage, our job is to find the time domain current. Once we find the time domain current, we can write the RMS value. So what we do is we convert this full thing into phasor. So in phasor, the resistance would remain resistance as 100 ohm. My inductor would now become ZL, which is equal to J times omega naught L. I know the value of omega naught, I know the value of L. So I can write ZL. This capacitor, I would replace it with ZC. Value would be given by 1 upon J omega naught C. Another resistance of 50 ohm, R2. And then I have these two points, A and B. And I have connected here a voltage source, phasor, V, which is given by 230 angle of 0. Right, this is the voltage phasor that I have connected. Any doubt? Anyone has any doubt here? Okay, so now first step was convert, like first step is in a way, zeroth step is to define all the voltage and current in time domain, right? Earlier it was only given in RMS values. Convert the circuit into phasor. Then you solve this circuit for this current, I phasor. So what is V phasor by I phasor? It is actually the Z equivalent of this full network, right? Z equivalent of the full network between point A and B, right? What is Z equivalent of the full network? That is, you can put ZC in parallel with R2, right? You put ZC in parallel with R2. Then you have series ZL and then you have series R1. This is nothing but Z equivalent, right? So you can use the same basic parallel laws of resistance, right? R1, R2 upon R1 plus R2. You can apply on Z1, Z2 upon Z1 plus Z2. You would get an equivalent impedance Z. Once you get an equivalent impedance Z, you can find V phasor by I phasor is this. So that would give you I phasor. something, angle something, right? And this is nothing but your RMS value. So you get your answer. Any doubt? So this is very basic thing and we'll now build up on it. If you have any doubt in this, feel free to ask. Yeah, so if you see in phasor equivalent, we have already shown that your Z, your capacitor and your resistance, all three in a way behaves as a resistance of a value which is either ZC, ZL or R, right? And our basic KCL, KVL laws are also applicable, right? So whatever we were doing, whatever was applicable to resistance in a normal circuit, here it is applicable to impedance. So if there are two things connected in parallel, two resistance, the net resistance is given by R1, R2 upon R1 plus R2. Here two Z are connected in parallel, right? One Z is real, one Z is imaginary. Still you net Z is given by Z1, Z2 upon Z1 plus Z2. So whatever laws were applicable in the DC circuit analysis of a linear circuit are also applicable to phasors of a linear circuit in time domain. Is that okay? Yeah. So now you see this is I is a phasor. You have a magnitude, let me call it I RMS. And you have an angle, let me call it as theta, just theta. Right? Now you can write this thing in time domain as RMS value multiplied by root 2. Which will be the peak value, cos of omega naught t plus theta. Now theta here can be negative, then it will come as negative, right? And you already know omega naught, because you know the circuit is operating at 104 radians per second, so you convert it into time domain. Yeah, sometimes you may be expected not just to give RMS value, but to give exact time domain answer, then you can report this as the answer. Any other doubt? Is that okay? Right. So this is sort of very basic question, right? Now we'll build up on this, but before we move ahead, let me also ask you to draw the phasor diagram of this network. What do we mean by phasor diagram? I'll explain it. So let me redraw this network. Sorry. Yeah. R1, ZL, ZC, R2, right? I want you to draw the V phasor and I phasor in the same diagram, right? So in other words, I would ask you to draw the phasor diagram of this particular circuit. So since I have not defined any phase or any angle, you can take any one of them at angle 0, right? Up to you. You can take voltage at angle 0 or current at angle 0, or you can take any other phasor. For example, this is just I and V, right? Now here there'll actually be some I1 and here current may be some I2 phasor, right? Similarly, voltage here may be some V1 phasor, voltage here may be some V2 phasor, voltage here may be some V3 phasor, right? So any current, any voltage, you can represent it as zero phasor, and then you can start drawing the phasor diagram. So now what is the first option? If you just have one element, you usually take consider current or voltage as a phasor, right? The main current or voltage. And then based on that, you can try to draw the voltage phasor. But here the problem is, just by inspection, you cannot be very sure if this full network is either resistive or inductive or capacitive, right? Because it would depend on their relative value. So one option is that, okay, now you solve for this network, you find the Z equivalent. If you, let's say, find Z equivalent, which is some magnitude of Z angle, some theta, where theta comes out to be positive, okay, then you can draw this thing. No problem, right? But then in general, the approach here is that we start with not with phasor I or phasor V, but we start with one of the element which is inside. For example, let me start with phasor V3. You all can see where V3 is? right? All of you can see where V3 is. V3 is the phasor which is appearing across resistance R2, the voltage phasor across R2. Let me consider this as a reference. Now, what is the current that is flowing in R2? Resistive. So, this is your current, I2. Right? What is the current that is flowing in capacitor? It is capacitive, so voltage would be leading, right? Sorry, the current would be leading the voltage. So, this is your current. Current would be leading the voltage in capacitor. And therefore, this is the current I1. Is that okay? Now, what is this total current I? Total current I is KCL equation I1 plus I2. And therefore, I can show this as my resultant current I. Right? Up till this point, is it clear? Till this point, is it clear to all of you? Anyone has any doubt? Okay. So, once I know current, then can I write what is phasor V1? Phasor V1, which is across R1. Current that is flowing through R1 is given by phasor I. So, what is voltage across resistance R1? It is in the same angle. There is no angle change across resistance. Only magnitude will get changed. So, fictitiously, I can draw this as phasor V1. What about phasor V2? It is an inductor. So, current would be lagging. So, phasor across V2 would be given by. And what is the resultant voltage? It is addition of phasor V1 plus V2 plus V3. Right? So now you add. Maybe you can, what you can do is you can add two of them and you get V1 plus V2 and then you add this with phasor V3 so as to get resultant phasor V. So now in a way you have phasor V and phasor I in the same plot. And obviously, this angle would change depending on the exact values of resistance, inductor, and capacitor. Right? But this is in a way a more generalized approach, and you could actually plot all the phases in the same field, and you can visualize. If you know these values accurately, right? For example, let's say I knew the exact value of ZC, exact value of R. Then when I am approximately drawing the phasor, I could have, instead of drawing approximately, I could have drawn it to the scale, right? And then all those additions would have been very accurate and would have given me finally the angle that I am looking for, right? So you could have used this as also to just solve the whole problem, right? Instead of writing equations. Is that okay? Anyone has any doubt in this problem? Then I would ask you to solve the following problem, or maybe I can help you write some equations and then we can see how to take it forward. Okay, let's do an example. I have a resistance of 10 ohms, a voltage source where I have written 10 cos of 40 voltage, capacitor of 0.1 farad, 1 Henry. How many of you have solved tutorial? Some of you. So, there was current dependent current source, voltage dependent voltage source. Okay. Two of IX. So, this one is a current dependent current source where the current that is flowing in the capacitive branch IX gets multiplied by 2 and that current flows in the other branch. So, this is current dependent current source. And you have an inductor of 0.5 Henry. Okay. So I have given you all the values. So, the problem here is to find I of X. You need to find I of X. Now this problem itself makes it obvious that I've given you a source in time domain, right? So I'm expecting an answer also in time domain, right? Don't just leave it at phasor, or don't just give me RMS value or something. It's an AC circuit. I've given you voltage in time domain. You give me answer also in time domain. So what do we do? Already we have voltage defined in time domain. Already one of the reference voltages is defined. So that is actually little bit advanced topic, I would suggest, right? For instance, some of you may be doing E210 in this semester.
Next semester,
right? So there you would talk about, I hope you would talk about current mirrors. So what is a current mirror? Whatever current is flowing here, same current flows there, right? So if you see, in a way, that is current dependent current source. I hear, right? So also you can use op amps to build such kind of sources. Also much later, you would also realize that in a way transformer or coils can also sort of act as a current dependent current source, right? So practically there are not just one, there are a lot of things, but in this course, we usually restrict it to just this nice symbol and we don't really talk about how to realize it. But physically they exist. It's not something hypothetical or fictitious. Okay, now let's start with, first thing is that we want to convert this into phasors. Right? So convert this source into phasor. This would be 20 by root 2, angle 0. Why? Because already angle 0 was given. Somewhere let us write down the frequency, which is 4, right? 4 radians per second. And you have a resistance here of 10 ohm. You have either, now you can represent like Z as block also. So you have a ZL, you have a ZC, ZL1, ZC1. Sorry? Yeah, 0.1. I'm sorry. Yeah, good that you pointed out. Let me just check. 0.1 farad. Yeah. Sorry. This is 2 times capital Ix now, where Ix was the current flowing in this direction. You see, I am converting everything into phasor. So the voltage current dependent current source also, if you want to convert it, you would see that the equivalent phasor follows the same law as that of the time domain source. And then you have another source here, which is ZL2, right? So I'm not writing the values of ZL1, ZL2, and ZC1. That I am assuming, and now you would be able to write yourself, right? So you have circuit in phasor domain. Now let's say question says us to find it using nodal analysis. So you apply nodal analysis here, right? When we want to apply nodal analysis, what do we do? First thing is, we define voltages at nodes. So let us see how many nodes are there. How many nodes are there? 1, 2, 3. How many nodes are there? 4 nodes. Right? Total 4 nodes. 1 node, 2 node, 3 node, 4 node. Right? One of the node we can mark as 0. Why? Because none of the nodes are marked as 0. Which one do you want to mark as 0? Always, usually we prefer the bottom one, right? Which has a lot of things connected. So we would mark this as 0. But that would not affect your answer, right? You can mark anything else as 0 also. So this is at 0 potential. And with respect to this, we define the potential at these 3 nodes as V1, V2, and V3. Right? All these now, if you see, everything is phasor. It's just the thing, whatever we did for DC circuit, we are doing the same, but now everything is in phasors. We mark nodes V1, V2, and V3, right? What is the next step? Here, first thing you can observe that V1 is anyways known, right? So V1 phasor is 20 by root 2 angle 0. You can write it either in a polar form or in rectangular form. In rectangular form, this would be 20 by root 2 cos omega t plus j sin omega, which is just this, right? So this is polar form, and this is right. So once you write these things, so you convert phasor in, you have phasor voltage V1, you already know. Now what do? You write KCL equations at node 2 and node 3, right? Once you write KCL equation in node 2 and 3, then you can solve it. I think we'll stop. I'll continue it in the next lecture.